Hey everyone, welcome to another 360 in 360, where we cover a certain technology 360 degrees in 360 seconds. For this one, I wanted to actually dive into Azure Storage Blob permissions. So I can think about, well, look, I have a storage account. So that storage account lives within a certain region. Has certain characteristics, replication, the exact SKU of the storage account. And I have different services that are available within the storage account. I can think about things like table, queue, SMB files, and then blob. And there are various types of blob. Block blob, page blob, append blob. But what I want to dive into is really focus on the blob, but also look at what are those permissions that I can actually leverage. And so if we think about just blob, there's actually two planes when I think about many data technologies. I can think about a control plane. So I'm going to think about there's the control plane. And then there's actually a data plane. And they may have separate permission structures. They have different ways to interact with them. And that's very applicable to blob. Now, if I think about just a regular storage account, obviously it's part of Azure Resource Manager. So when I think about this control plane, well, that's on. That's the Azure Resource Manager. And we can think about, well, there's Azure Active Directory. There's users in that. And I can use that for role-based access control. So on the storage account, well, there's role-based access control. At the blob level, the control plane, there's role-based access control. And what I can do is when I think about that control plane, I create containers. So for blob, a blob lives in a container. So I can think about, well, in that control plane, let's carry that on. I create a container and I can have multiple containers and I can do role-based access control on that container. So I can do kind of RBAC there based on those users from Azure AD. There's various types of role-based access control for the control plane, that management plane, who can create containers, who can modify it. There's an owner, there's readers, I have all these different roles available to me. But it's all about the management plane. For the actual data plane, so on the data plane, for example, let's say we have blobs. So I have kind of blob one, we have blob two. How do I access the data? Well, as part of the storage account, we actually have access keys. So a feature of the storage account, we have access key. Now these give me total control. There's access key one and access key two. The reason there's two of them is that if I was using the access key one and I had to regenerate it because it got compromised, super important I keep these protected, I could switch to using access key two while I regen one, then switch back to using one. So we have these two access keys. Now, absolutely, to access the data plane, I can use the access key. So armed with the access key using the REST API, I can go and access any blob in any container in the storage account. The access key is per storage account. But these are so powerful. If I had applications using that storage account, I don't want to just kind of give them that access key. I want to be more granular because the access key, if I use that, like I say, that kind of gives me full. That's full everywhere. Full on those blobs, on all containers, all services, tables, queues, files, whatever there is. And so we think about getting more granular. And so now we start thinking about, okay, so what can I do kind of focused on the data plane? So we have something called shared access signatures. So these SAS, a shared access signature. And there's actually two types, there's actually three types. But for now, I can think about, well, there's an account shared access signature and a service
shared access signature. Now, as you might imagine, based on those names, this account shared access signature applies at the account level. So when I create an account, well, that loops all the way to there. So I can, through that shared access signature, specify one or more types of service that you can have access to through that signature. And I'm going to use that signature when I connect using the REST API. I'm going to pass that as part of it. So an account SaaS, multiple different services. It can include permissions like creating containers, removing containers, but its granularity is at the storage account level. And then I can create a service shared access signature. Now that can only be for one of the services. So I can create it for blob or for files or for queue. And for this one, well, this service SaaS is actually going to live within a particular container. So it lives within the container and it can apply to the container and then all the blobs in that container, or it can actually apply to a particular blob. You can access this blob and only this blob. Now for both of these, they can be ad hoc. I just create them. So I can think about these being ad hoc if I create them in this manner. And I can specify a kind of time, a start time and an end time. If I'm doing the time from now, the best practice is set it 15 minutes in the past, just in case there's some kind of time skew going on. I can specify the various permissions. I can specify IPs that I'm allowed to connect. And I can specify whether it's kind of HTTPS only or HTTPS and HTTP. The recommended would just be HTTPS. But I can do and HTTP if I really wanted to. But HTTPS is better, it's obviously more secure. And also, if you think about what's gonna happen, these shared access signatures we're gonna send often will be appended to the end of the request. So if I send that in plain text, well, then I can see it. If it's HTTPS, remember HTTPS gets established first. If I'm a client and I'm talking to the Azure Storage endpoint, the first thing that happens is I establish that SSL, that TLS connection, just between those two IPs. Nothing is sent yet. Then I send the request, and that request over the encrypted connection would include the signature. So it's a much better way to kind of keep it secure. So I can create these ad hoc shared access signatures. So I could absolutely create a SaaS that says, hey, you can only access this container and the blobs in it, you can only read them, and then it expires in 2 hours. And if I'm creating those ad hoc shared access signatures, it is good to keep them a very short lifetime in case I need to revoke it, because really I can't revoke it. The only way to revoke an ad hoc shared access signature is these signatures get signed. And they're going to get signed by one of the account keys. So you pick which one. So I say, well, I'm going to sign it with account key one. So you're going to sign them. So if you wanted to revoke an ad hoc signature you created, the only way to do that would be to regenerate the key. So it would invalidate the signature. It wouldn't work anymore. So I can do that. So that's ad hoc. Remember, these are all about the data plane. So these are giving me permissions to either all the blobs in a certain container based on the permissions I set. I can just read it, or I can read and write to it, or I can, you specify those things. Or to a particular blob. You can only access this blob. Now the other thing I can do is I can actually create something called a stored access policy. Now I can only do this for service shared access signatures. So what I could do is, we'll do another color, I'll do it red this time. So I can actually, under the container, create this stored access policy. And the stored access policy has kind of a time, a start and end, and permissions, those two things. So now what I can do, instead of creating an ad hoc service SaaS, I can create one based off of the stored access policy. So now I could create a new SaaS from here. So now it's a service SaaS built from that store. So it references the stored access policy. And once again, I could apply that to container or an individual blob. The benefit here is, well, A, I don't have to manually specify the time and the permissions every time I want to use it. But if I modify the stored access policy, it will reflect any of those SASs that I've generated from it. So if I suddenly change that stored access policy to expire earlier, then that automatically would expire earlier as well. It's based on that configuration. So that gives me more flexibility, but again, it's only for those service SASs. So let's kind of recap for a second. I have the management plane, the control plane, that's Azure Resource Manager. And as part of that, we have these access keys. They're what I use to access the data plane. That gives me full access, or I think about, I'll create these shared access signatures, either applying to the whole account, and I can have multiple services, or with a service SaaS, it's only one of the services, and it's scoped at, in the blob case, a particular container, and all the blobs in it, or a particular blob. Instead of doing ad hoc, I can create a policy within the container, I can have up to five of them, I believe, and then I can build those service SaaSes off of the stored access policy. So then instead of having to regenerate the access key to evoke it, I can just change the stored access policy. So that works, but it's still requiring kind of, well, I'm storing these things somewhere, I'm generating, I have to use the access key to generate these SaaS things. With this fantastic Azure AD thing up here. So what we also have the ability to do now is I can actually think about a user delegation key and a user delegation SaaS. So now what I can do is, as part of my role-based access control, I can actually apply, so I think about that's control. Now I can also kind of do data RBAC. There are kind of built-in roles all about blob, contributor, owner, reader, key generator. Maybe that's sharer. I have to check exactly what they are. But now I can do data RBAC. So now I can give a user permissions at the container level for data. And the way this actually works behind the scenes, if I think about it, is it's going to get a user delegation key. So now if I think about the blob within that service, well, in addition to kind of that regular RBAC, I'll now be able to generate, I'll do a different color again. Let's say now we are gold. Now I kind of have this user delegation key. So when I want to go and actually access now data, I can make a call to say, hey, I need to get my user delegation key. Based on the permission set, that's what my key will kind of specify. These are the permissions I have available to me. Then I can create a new type of SaaS. I can create a user delegation SaaS. So it's still a shared access signature. But now instead of being signed by the account key, it's going to get signed by my user delegation key. Now it can have the full permissions that's available, i.e. what I've been RBAC'd at the data level, or it can be a subset. So I can have less than what's been assigned to me. So maybe I have contributor, but maybe this user delegation SaaS only has read, but it can't have more. I can't only be assigned read here, and I want to give myself write on this SaaS. So it's all a subset of what I have. But now I'm using just regular RBAC. On the storage account, I can think about, I go in and I give a role. Blob data reader, blob data contributor, blob data owner. So now when I want to go and access the data, rather than trying to go and get an account or a service SaaS or the account key, I just make an OAuth2 call to the Azure Resource Manager. I say, hey, I want to get my user delegated key. This is who I am for this, this storage account for Blob. It will return that to me. Now I can construct my SaaS using that key. And then using that user delegated SaaS, I'll be able to go and access the blobs in that container based on the permissions. This is obviously the preferred. So if I have a choice, this is kind of the star option. Using that user delegation, it is better than SaaS from an account or service perspective. So not having to worry about storing or accessing or using that master account key. All of these fundamentally rely on that access key. I have to have the access key to be able to sign them. This does not use that. This is using that user delegation key that is generated based on my user account, my managed identity account within Azure Active Directory. So I'm obviously over time as usual. If you want to stick around, I'll actually show this to you now and let's see these various options in action. For this demonstration, I'm going to use both the Azure portal and the free Azure Storage Explorer tool. Now, starting off in the portal, I'm looking at a storage account and we can see straight away I have access control. This is where I could assign roles at the account level. And there are many roles related to storage. There are things around storage account contributors, key operators, and you'll actually see these storage blob data roles. And I'm going to talk more about those in a second. And then we also have the all-powerful access keys. Now, you would normally protect these with your life. You would definitely not create a video showing the keys. If you have these keys, you can do anything with this storage account. And you always have to think about not just the concern of people taking your data. Let's say people could write data. I pay for consumption. They could store a huge amount of data that I have to pay for. They might write bad data that I'd then be responsible for. So it's important we protect these keys. But I could absolutely use these keys to connect. For example, if I actually just navigate down and I go and look at my containers, I have various containers in my storage account. If I went to images, well, I can see the content. We can even select one. If I select edit, we can see the content. Now, remember, this is the data plane. This is not the control plane. It's showing me my authentication method is using the access key. So because my account has permissions on the storage account to list and enumerate the account keys, it's just grabbing the account key and using that to interact with the data plane. If I was to switch to my Azure AD account, I'd actually lose the access because my regular role-based access control on the data plane, I have no access to this data. So I'm going to switch back to the access key. Now we talked about the shared access signatures. I can create an account SaaS. So here, under settings, there's shared access signature. Notice I can select more than one service. I can say the types of resource I want to be allowed to access, what permissions I have, start and end times, allowed IP addresses, and the default HTTPS only. And then of course, I select which key is going to sign it, one of those master account keys. So I could generate a SaaS from this. It's going to show it to me for blob, for file, for queue, for table, because I selected all of those things. If I took, for example, the blob one and copied that, if I jumped over to my Azure Storage Explorer and did connect, well, I can connect using a shared access signature URI. I could then just paste that in, click next. And there you can see there's my SaaS. And with that access key, I can go and look at everything within there. There's my images, I can see them. And once again, I have the permissions because this is acting on the data plane. I can actually now go and get that and I can view the content. And there's Ollie, my dog. And I would have whatever permissions that I had selected as part of that SaaS. So we'll go ahead and detach from there. Remember, once I have this, the only way to revoke it past this normal expiry time would be to regenerate the signing key. So I'd have to go to my access keys, regenerate.
So that's regenerated that key. If I was to go back again and try and attach, we use exactly the same key that we had before. So it's connected, but now it's failed. It can't authenticate. It's actually no good anymore because I have regenerated the key that signed the request. And I could also generate those keys from here as well. So I have a connection as my account. And I can see here, it's my storage account. I can see all my various storage accounts I have. And I could get a shared access signature and select the services. So this Azure Storage Explorer gives me that ability as well. And now I want to think about, well, I don't want the whole account. I want the ability at a service level to maybe pick a particular container or maybe even a particular blob. Now I can do it from this tool. So here you can see, look at my blob containers. I could create a shared access signature for the container. So I could right click and I could do get a shared access signature and I just want read permission. If I click create and then copy that, and then we'll jump back and we'll connect using that key I just generated. So we scroll up. So there's my attached containers. There's my images using the SAS. And sure enough, I have access. But notice I can't access other containers. I'm only seeing that one for that service SAS because it was at that blob level. Now what I could also do is I could generate one directly on a blob. So actually just jump over to the portal for a second so you can see both ways to interact. So now I'll go to my containers. I'll go to my images. And notice I have the option to create access policies. We're going to come back to that in a second. But now I'm going to say, hey, let's generate a SAS. And again, I could do exactly the same thing in this tool. Actually, I have too many tabs open there. Let's close some of these tabs for a second. I'm getting lost where I am. So let's disconnect this one. Detach. If I go back to this one that's actually connected as me, I could do the same thing. I could right click and say, get shared access signature. So now what this will do is it's going to give me a SAS. Again, I can set all the various options I want, which key is going to sign it. And there is the token. So this time, if I connect with this, and what's interesting about this one, I could actually use this because it's directly to a particular blob. I could actually just paste that in. And there we go. Again, it's HTTPS. It's not like I sent this plain text. It establishes the TLS connection first, then it sent the request with the signature, which is the bit I need to protect. So I have that capability as well. But these are all ad hoc. I'm just creating them. So the other thing I can actually do, if I go back to my container, I can create an access policy. Here I could do add policy. Read for month. So the permissions we'll give it, we'll do read and list. The expiry time, notes you can put in a start and an end time. So we could just do today, 26th, and the expiry time will go to May. Remember, be careful with the start time. Make sure it's at least 15 minutes in the past. It says my read for month. Now, if I went back, save that. So now I could actually generate a SAS based off of the access policy. And the Azure portal doesn't seem to expose all of these options the same way. But here I could say, hey, look, read for the month. All of these are now grayed out. It's just reading it from the policy. And I could now generate just for that criteria. So great, we have all these different types of shared access signature. But that's me still dealing with that master access key, one or two. Now the other option we had is if we go ahead and look both on the resource group, at the storage account, all of those different levels, we have regular Azure role-based access control. But what's interesting to me is I can do it at the container level. And we have these data roles. So if we scroll down, well, we can see there's storage blob data reader. There is storage blob data contributor, data owner, and delegator. I actually have that user delegation key. So if we look at one of these, let's look at contributor for a second. If we look at the permissions, it's using the storage resource provider. You'll notice resource type management, the control plane. Well, it doesn't have a huge amount. If I look here, I can generate a user delegation key. That's the important part. So that's at that control plane, it can generate a user delegation key for this particular container. But then if we keep scrolling down, now we have data. And we'll see for the blob service blobs, I can read, write, delete, and other actions. And I can move blobs. But you see there's discrete data actions available. The owner would have all of these. So now I can grant this. This is far more interesting. Now if I actually go back to what I've done on my account, if I look at the role assignments, you can see I've actually given Clark Kent the storage blob data reader. Sorry, not contributor, the reader role. And if we look back at what I did, if we look at the Azure Storage Explorer, I actually connected both as myself, then I also connected as Clark. Now, the only other permission I did have to give him was reader. He needs reader to be able to enumerate the storage accounts and the containers. So if I go back to that same storage account, go to the blob containers, so he can read them all. So there's all the different containers. I'll select one. I have no access. But if I go to images, I do have access because it's getting that user delegation SAS that's signed by my key that says, well, for this particular container, I have reader rights. So now I can actually go in and look at any of those blobs. And the blob reader permission also gives me that list ability. There's my two dogs stealing what's left of my cereal. But I wouldn't be able to upload. Notice upload, if I do upload files, and if I select something, so let's quickly select a file, really doesn't matter what it is. There we go. Upload. So I'm trying to transfer a file up, it fails. I only have the reader capability. So that's kind of walking through all of those different options. Using the master account key, generating SASes both at the container level and at the individual blob level, and then kind of using the Azure AD RBAC, which is really the best option if I can use that, because I don't have to interact with the storage account key. And obviously, if you ever do have your storage account key compromised in any way, like you create a video of them, make sure the next thing you do is you go in and you regenerate them. Remember, not just because maybe you have sensitive data. I don't want people copying data up there that cost me money to store. There might be bad content. And if people are reading it, obviously I pay the network egress charges. So make sure you regenerate any compromised key.
So I hope that was useful. I never in a million years thought I'd be 360 seconds on this one. I should have said 360 minutes, in which case I've come in nicely under. But I do hope that useful helped clear things up. If it was, please subscribe, like, please comment, please share. Until the next time, take care of yourselves.